So it's been a sort of unusual day, has it?
Yes, I thought something was very strange because I managed to get a parking space at work. They waved me straight in, which doesn't normally happen.
Well, we do have influence, though I didn't think we had when I got to your Nick. Now, on parade here, all the usual suspects, former cast members of The Bill, family members, your mum, Angela, your dad, John, your sister, Fiona, and your brother, Matthew. And with your stepson, Benny, your partner for the past 14 years, Sharon Martin. Sharon, you fell for Mark, literally.
Yes, I did, actually. After a few too many drinks in the old red line in Islington, I fell off my stool and he came over and picked me up.
Literally.
It's a lovely way to start, isn't it? Well, Mark Wingett, this is your life. Ever since the pilot episode of The Bill 17 years ago, you've played a leading role in television's most successful police drama. Along with the law, there's been a fair bit of disorder. Here are a few mugshots.
Morning, son. Welcome aboard.
Thank you, sir. Sarge.
Did you do any early turn, did you?
I just thought I'd get stuck in, Sarge.
Good, good.
I mean, you don't want someone's head on a platter for this, do you?
What you fail to understand, Jim, is that someone's head is already on a platter. Mine.
Now, this reminded me of something in the Peter Haynes case.
I remember the case, but I thought the idea that Haynes had an accomplice was looked into at the time.
Well, we questioned everyone that Haynes had contact with and drew a blank.
Jim!
We put out an APB and the heavy mob have responded in force. Now, The Bill's pilot show in 1983 was called Wooden Top, and Trudy Goodwin, that's when you met Mark.
Yes, it was, and I always remember we were rehearsing in a wooden scout hut down at Kingston, right down by the Thames, and it was during a really hot period in the year, and I'll never forget that Mark, actually, was the one who persuaded a lot of us to go in swimming in the Thames at lunchtime. And what you have to understand about Mark is actually he's got a bit of a thing about water. I mean, he likes getting wet and actually likes the water to be as muddy and as cold as possible.
Absolutely.
And with this kind of infectious enthusiasm he has for most things, and especially for swimming or anything to do with getting wet, he persuaded most of the cast to go in the water. How we didn't get dysentery, typhoid, and how we ever got that pilot made, I shall never know.
Well, fortunately, the only thing to run and run was the series, so that's... now, Graham Cole, you've observed Mark's work over the years.
Mark, to those of us that have been with him for 15 years, affectionately known as Damage.
Thank you, Graham.
And there is for that. We spend 80% of our time on the streets of London. If we've got a disused warehouse, a school, Mark will go straight in there, find some piece of equipment he can rip off the wall, decide whether he can actually make things work or not. I do a lot of car shots with him, and he is a nightmare, because before they shout action, you've got to make sure he's not put it in reverse, yank the handbrake on as hard as he could, touch every knob and lever in the whole of the car. But he's a delight to work with, and we're really proud that you've done it, mate. Good on you.
Excellent. Thank you.
Well, long before all this, you played a different character in the 1979 movie Quadrophenia. You were one of the mods versus the rockers in those epic beach battles at Brighton. One of your co-stars became used to men behaving badly, and from the set of Where the Heart Is, here's district nurse Leslie Ash.
Hi, Damage. I don't actually know where you got the name Brain Damage from. Or maybe I do, yes.
It was a little film we did together called Quadrophenia 20 years ago. I think you were about 15 years of age. Well, as you can see, I've had a total career change. But you've done fantastically well in yours. I'm really proud of you. But have a great evening tonight. I'll see you soon.
Right, back to the nitty-gritty. Mark Christopher Wingett, you were born on January the 1st, 1961, at St Mary's Hospital in Melton Mowbray in Leicestershire, the birthplace of the pork pie. But, John, your firstborn wasn't exactly a porker.
No, he wasn't. He weighed in at 5 pounds, 4 ounces, very small. That's probably because he was 3 weeks premature. And that is the only time that he's been early or on time in his life.
Now, Mark, I'll just remind you that your father was in the Royal Navy and became a lieutenant. When you were 17 months old, he was posted to Malta. Just before you left, your Uncle Peter took some home movies, and this is your film debut at the age of 17 months. Back in England, you're chosen to be page boy at your Auntie Judy's wedding to Uncle Dennis. You were 2 years old, and the family worked out a little performance for you. Isn't that right, Auntie Pat?
Yes, that's right. Uncle Peter had been teaching Mark for quite some time, and in the middle of Dad's father of the bride speech, he was going on, people were getting restless, and all of a sudden a little voice says, "Belt up, Grandad." Of course, the whole place fell apart. End of speech.
Later, I was in my first professional show, and my granddad came to see it, and it was a real blood and thunder show, lots of bad language. It was a matinee, and he fell asleep, was snoring through it.
Your sister Fiona is born in 1964, and in November of that year, there's another Navy posting for your father, and off you all go to Singapore. When you're five, you started the Army School in Majadee. Why not the Navy School, Angela?
Well, he was just born one day too late to go to the Navy School.
That's a senior service for you. Right. At the end of 1966, the family returns to Portsmouth, and after a time in married quarters, the Wingetts move into their own home in Cowplain. Younger brother Matthew arrives in 1968. You start to make regular appearances at Padnell Road Infants and Junior School.
And that's where I had to demote you to King.
Nearly 30 years on, your old head teacher, Harry Jones. Doesn't sound like a bad deal to be demoted to King.
Well, we used to have end of term concerts, and Mark's class and another class were doing an operetta, and he had his eye on the part of the prince, but he was taller than the other lad, and so the other lad got the job of the prince, and you took the part of the king. He didn't get annoyed, he didn't show it anyway, and it was very good performance indeed. I'd like to think, Mark, that some of the work we did in music and drama, in which you became passionately interested, had some part to play in fashioning your career as an actor, and a very good actor, I might say.
Thank you, Mr.
And I wish you all the best, and I'm sure you'll agree that we couldn't have done those concerts with all the music and all the drama without a dedicated staff and wonderful support from parents. Wish you well.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
The next school is Horndean Secondary in Portsmouth. And Liam Murphy, you were in the same class as Mark, and one summer you went west on a cycling holiday.
That's absolutely right. When we were, I think, in the fourth or fifth year, 1976, we headed off to the West Country on our push bikes. First time you've been away without your folks, I think. And that year, very hot year, very big hills in Devon and Cornwall. By the time we got down there, because the sun was always on our left, we were brown all down the left side, white all down the right side, with calf muscles the size of, well, Incredible Hulks.
Now, you're a dab hand at impressions as well. There's your Frank Spencer. So, you joined the school's drama club, and you're so promising you're chosen for extra tuition. Those hour-long sessions, paid for by the Hampshire Education Authority, were the only formal acting training that you ever got. Were they useful?
They were. They really were. Yes, they were fantastic.
Well, you're a bit of an all-rounder as well. You play the bugle for the Nautical Training Corps, and just in case, you take up martial arts and become a brown belt in judo. There's the budding Bruce Lee. And that's with your sister Fiona there on the right. Then you buy your first LP. It's by ABBA. And for the next year... I was looking forward to reading that bit. But for the next year, you dress in flares and you listen mostly to Tubular Bells by Mike Oldfield. But then you make a dramatic change of gear. Fiona, you remember that?
Overnight, he became a punk. And he used to stand his hair up on end with sugar and water and wear these bondage trousers with the chains in between the legs. And he used to like to go out in a particular outfit, and he'd hide it as he went out and go around the corner. And Mum and Dad never knew, but he'd put on, that isn't until now, and put on a bin liner to go out in.
But Matt, you used to share a bedroom with Mark.
Yeah, that's right. Mark's 7 years older than me, and so when I was nine, he was 16, I used to look up to him. I remember one time he was going to a jam concert, and he said, I'm going to tell you what I'm going to wear. And he reached into the cupboard and he pulled out a coat hanger, and on the coat hanger there was a dry cleaning dust cover, a bag for a suit. And underneath the dry cleaning dust cover there was nothing, just a coat hanger. And he said, that's what I'm going to wear. I'm going to wear that. I'm going to screw it up, put it in my pocket. When I get round the corner, I'm going to put it on. And whatever you do, don't tell Dad. So, Mark, your secret is safe.
Not embarrassing at all.
So you're 16, Mark, and you're chosen from 2,000 applicants to become a member of Michael Croft's National Youth Theatre. In 1977, you get a small part in their summer production of Julius Caesar. The following year, you get the lead in a new Peter Terson play, England My Own.
And I knew right away you were the actor I was looking for.
She found you, former casting director Esther Charkham. Yes, so you were looking for Mr. Wright.
Yes, I was looking for Mr. Wright, and I did find him. I went to see England My Own, and because I was casting Quadrophenia, and I was looking for lots of rebellious youths, mods, rockers, everything.
So it worked.
Yes. And he was quite extraordinary in that. I mean, he was very powerful, and he had an intensity, and I introduced him to Frank Rodham, and you got the part, didn't you?
I certainly did, yeah.
Thank you. Well, according to records, you were halfway through your A-level studies, but your headmaster gives you time off, and you spend the summer making that extraordinary film.
He goes down his feet.
It's off, I'll sit down then, eh?
Yeah.
What have we got the ump about?
Eh?
So why are you so umpy?
It's nothing. Just looking at the sea, that's all.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Christ.
Take your feet off the table.
And here tonight, Quadrophenia co-stars Phil Daniels, Phil Davis, Trevor Laird and John Altman. Phil Daniels.
Yeah, when I first met Mark, he was a... this great big punk rocker. I was really surprised when I saw him, and I was this sort of flash git from London. So I sort of took him under my wing for a while, and I'm surprised we're all still here, really.
You're not the only one.
Phil Davis.
It was very interesting watching that clip of Mark eating the sandwich there, because that was our first day's shooting and Mark's first time on a film set. And I remember he devoured the whole sandwich, and then we did another take and he devoured that one. I think we did about 17 and he devoured them all, and then we broke for lunch.
Frank Rodham always liked improvisation. He made documentaries before he made that picture, and so he allowed us to ad lib a bit. The producers, to maximise the audience, wanted to make it an AA picture, but swearing made it an X, you know. And, the trouble was, Mark was only 17, so couldn't get to see it. But then again, his name is brain damaged, so I'm sure he got in somehow. Right?
John Altman, a year after the movie, you and Mark studied method acting.
Yes, indeed. You remember those, we put the world to rights in my old bed, sitting in Meadowvale, and we used to stay the night, cook your breakfast and all the rest of it. That's some great times. And, we studied the method, didn't we? Stanislavski at the Actors' Centre, and the director of this workshop, you remember, he put a chair in the middle of the workshop. He said, right, I want you to use the chair, use it, and create an environment. I can't remember what I did. I remember pretend I was a bus driver, I was in a cell or something, but you picked it up and hurled it at the wall and said, thank you, Mark, that was very interesting. And, anyway, we've been buddies for a long time since, haven't we? Yeah. Good times.
Thank you, gents. Thank you. Dear speech, Billy Murray, he's quietened down a bit since then, hasn't he?
Yeah, a great deal. Mark's one of the most sensitive, caring people I've ever met. And anyone in the cast can go to his dressing room and talk to him about any problem he's got. He won't give advice, he just counsels. We just all love him, he's a great guy.
Thank you. In 1979, with a touch of typecasting, you go on a nationwide tour with the Oxford Playhouse in a play about delinquent school kids called Class Enemy. The same year, you appear in your first television drama, a seafaring yarn called Ravelled Thread.
And, Mark, what a motley crew we made.
It's Jack Wilde. So, Jack, it wasn't plain sailing.
It certainly wasn't. Did you remember when we were filming that bit in Dartmouth where we had to make a rendezvous
with
a ship in the middle of the river?
Yeah.
Right, well, we tried this, but we kept on missing, didn't we? Because
the current kept taking us away.
We kept being swept out of sea, wasn't it? And, you know, we thought that was hysterical. And then the next minute, do you remember that...
Dead sheep.
That really finished us off, didn't it?
Oh, no, there's a dead sheep. What? There's a dead sheep.
Yeah, it was so Monty Python. Crazy. But, I mean, to make matters worse, it didn't even make the final edit, did it, that scene? So, you know, but you win some, lose some, don't you?
Yeah, never work with children or dead animals, that's the answer. Jack, thank you.
Good to see you. Thank you.
In the early 1980s, you were in great demand on stage and in a succession of screen roles.
Christmas is coming. The goose is getting fat. Pleased to put a penny. Yeah. Yeah, we learned that at school too, you know.
You're beautiful.
Don't cap it.
No. The shape of your head. From all angles.
Okay, you fancy me, but no chat, please.
You know, I've been coming here once a month for the last 8 months. Every time you hand me this case, you get the same look on your face.
What look is that?
Like you're handing over your life's work.
Private Schultz featured Coronation Street's Fred Elliott, John Savidant.
Hello, Mark, dear heart. And I always remember we were in Private Schultz, and I thought, this guy's so good and he's so real, they must have got a real soldier in. But then, of course, you always had that wonderful talent of making things look so easy, which, of course, is a very difficult thing to do. I have a wonderful time tonight. I suppose you'll get chicken legs again.
Thank you. 1984 comes your big break in The Bill. The show's a success and you become a regular member of the cast. In November 1986, you meet Sharon and your daughter Jamila is born in August 1992.
And Daddy, you know what I want to be.
Making her screen debut, Jamila Wingett. So, Jamila, you're 7 and a half, and you know exactly what you want to do.
I want to be an actress.
Mm. Oh, no!
Fair enough. Now, Mark, one of your off-screen activities is scuba diving, and as a qualified instructor, you act as technical advisor to the Bill, but you also dive for fun. And some of your diving mates are here tonight, as you'll have noticed. Well, now, with a starring role in a long-running drama, a loving relationship and a beautiful daughter, on the outside, you seem to have it all. But you had a problem. The storyline in The Bill has seen PC Carver's life spin out of control as he battles against drink. And that was something you had to face yourself at one time.
I had a drink problem. And with the help of a few friends, I've managed to not drink for a few years now.
Well, in The Bill, Carver's drinking takes him to rock bottom. This is a man in serious trouble.
Just stop the car!
No!
Right! Don't be in it!
Stop the car!
Get off me!
Don't be so...
Get off me!
Cover!
It's a long way down. Not a nice way to go. Struggling for breath, cold and dark.
Have you got anything to drink?
I'm arresting you on suspicion of murder. You do not have to say anything, but it may harm your defence if you do not mention...
Quick question, something which you need to rely on in court. Anything you do say may be given in evidence.
Do you want the duty solicitor?
You need legal representation, James, you know that.
Sir.
Well, in 1996, to mark your recovery, you returned to the stage for the first time in 12 years to star in the play Fool for Love. Andrew Paul, PC Dave Quinnan, you were in that play with Mark?
Yeah, that's right. And as you said, you know, it was the first time Mark was on stage for 12 years. And having had a similar break from live theatre myself, I know what that sort of does for an actor. Doubt sort of creep into your mind and you have this little ball of fear festering inside you. And after 12 years, Mark's festering ball must have been huge, but... coupled with the fact that he was coming to terms with something that he needed to come to terms with, the thing that struck me most about Mark at the time wasn't just his warmth and his humour or this incredible stage presence that he has. It was his courage, and amongst this company of actors, he's much loved and respected, and you deserve tonight, mate. Enjoy it. Good luck to you.
Cheers, mate.
Good. Happily, you and The Bill are in good health. 4 years ago, it was voted Best Drama in the National Television Awards. In 1997, the entire cast was presented with the ITV Personality Award by the Variety Club. Personally, you've just clocked up your 600th episode. And there's still your stage work. You appeared in Lone Star at the Red Lion, Islington, and you've got plans to direct the play in Australia. Hugh Higginson, you played Mark's brother in Lone Star.
Yeah, that's right, and we had a great time doing it. And before we used to do each performance, we used to go through what is euphemistically called a warm-up period, whereas most actors will kind of stand there and sing or, you know, wave around the wind like a dandelion or whatever. Mark's version of a warm-up was to kind of, like, say to me, right, are you ready? And then basically engage me in this enormous kind of, like, wrestling contest. Pin me down on the floor and most times end up sitting on top of me. So I actually ended up...
I like the way it's all one way.
So after four weeks of doing the play, I actually had more bumps and bruises than I did after 600 performances on The Bill. But I have to say that all that energy that Mark has, he does actually convert not only to his boisterous side, but also to his sensitive side, and it fuels his honesty and his integrity.
Well, it's almost time for a final evening all, but not quite. One popular member of the Bill team left after starring in the show for 14 years. But as a good friend, he wanted to be here tonight to give evidence on your behalf. It's Detective Inspector Burnside, Chris Ellison.
Yeah,
Right, you're on oath, Chris.
Yes.
What would you like to say?
Well, apart from the fact that he's one of my best mates, probably my best mate, and I love him, and he's a wonderful actor and all that, but he's the worst fisherman I've ever met. I went out fishing with him one day. He invited me, and we got there at 12, and he said it's going to be a great day's fishing, and we went out, and I caught a fish on the way out. Russell was there, and Mark's brother was there, four of us. And he said, don't bother with that, it's too small, throw it back. We'll catch plenty of those, we'll cook them on the way. I said, well, haven't you got any food on board? He said, no, I haven't got any food. No, we'll cook the fish as we catch it. So it came 6 o'clock, we hadn't caught any fish. We've been out there for 6 hours. I said, it's time we went back, Mark. He said, I'm sorry. He said, but there's a sandbar outside the land, so we can't go back till midnight. That was the worst time I've ever had at sea. One tin of vegetable soup between four people. Bless you. Bless you, bro. I want to work with you again soon.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Mark Wingett, This Is Your Life.
Victor Meldrew gets the builders in to do a loft conversion. One Foot of the Grave here on BBC One in half an hour.